that we celebrate as a church family. We've got those milestones written on my left on the banner. We've got the milestones in your bulletin. The milestones are in the hallway, in the narthex. And today we come to these two milestones: commitment to purity and passage to adulthood. Commitment to purity and passage to adulthood. And just in case you were thinking that neither of these apply to you, I just want to tell you that at the heart of both of these milestones is the idea that Jesus Christ just doesn't want to save us. Jesus wants to transform us as well. Jesus also wants to make us into his disciples. And so it's not enough simply to say a prayer and invite Jesus into your heart, although that is very important. I wouldn't want to miss that step in our journey with Jesus. But it's not enough just to simply pray that prayer and ask him into our hearts. God wants to also transform us. God wants to make us into Jesus' disciples. And so that's what we're going to be looking at today: becoming Jesus' disciples. You know, one of the most scariest things in the New Testament is at the very end of Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. This is probably his most well-known sermon, and he gets to the end of the Sermon on the Mount there in the Gospel of Matthew, and Jesus says to the people who are gathered around him, Jesus says, when the day of judgment comes, there will be those who will come to me, and they will say to me, Lord, Lord. And I will say to them, I'm sorry, but I never knew you. The question for us is, does Jesus know us? Does Jesus know us as his disciples, as true disciples? Does Jesus know us? Would you please pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son Jesus. We thank you not only for the cross and the empty grave, that act that has saved us from our sins and death, but we thank you that through his resurrection, through the power of the Holy Spirit, we can be transformed into new people. That you have called us to be Christ's disciples. And through that, change the world. God, bless the words of my mouth and the meditation of all the hearts and souls and the minds gathered in this place. May they be acceptable unto thee, O God, our rock and our salvation. Amen. So my family and I, we were coming back from vacation a few weeks back, right? And we stopped at a gas station to fill up. And as we pulled in, I noticed this group of bikers. These were your bikers. I mean, they had the leather jackets on, right? And on the back of their jackets, they had this insignia that represented who they were, who they belonged to, what organization they were, and the jackets read, "The disciples are the devil's disciples." The devil's disciples. Has anybody heard of the devil's disciples? Some of you have heard of the devil's disciples. I had never heard of the devil's disciples. There was one lady who was with them, and she didn't have a leather jacket on, but she had a T-shirt on, and on the back of her T-shirt it said, "Good girls go to church. Bad girls join the devil's disciples." And my oldest child, Emma, she looked at me and she said, "Dad, I think you need to go and talk to them about Jesus." And then one of my other daughters said, "Dad, I think you should go over there and tell them that they've misspelled disciples on their jackets." And I got to be honest with you, I did not feel the Spirit leading me to do either of those things. And so my oldest child in our van, she prayed for him as we pulled out of the gas station. But you know, it kind of begs the question, right? I mean, what's the disciple, whether it's of the devil, whether it's of Satan, or for us, Jesus Christ, what is a disciple? Well, in Greek, that term, that phrase disciple or disciples literally means to be a student or an apprentice of someone else. To be a student or to be an apprentice of someone else. That's what it means to be a disciple. So in the New Testament, there just weren't the big 12 disciples. Jesus had many disciples, many students, many who followed him as their teacher, as their rabbi. And so there were many, many disciples of Jesus Christ who are following him. And what I want us to do this morning, I want us to look biblically at what made up those disciples, what characterized them as disciples of Jesus. What is a disciple? What are the characteristics of a disciple as we look at the Bible and the New Testament? I've got four qualities, four characteristics of a disciple that I want to share with you this morning. It's not an exhaustive list. I'm sure there are other qualities, other characteristics to being a disciple of Jesus, but I've chosen these four. I think they're a pretty good four as we look at the characteristics of Jesus' disciples. And the first one is this. Jesus' disciples follow. It's the first characteristic. Jesus' disciples follow. And that might seem like an easy concept to grasp. However, as I was preparing for my message today, it occurred to me that, you know, we have a whole generation of kids growing up that what they know about following has to do with Twitter or Instagram, right? If you want to follow someone, you're going to join them on one of these social media sites. And not only do you follow people, but you want others to follow you, right? And so my kids will post a picture on Instagram, and immediately they look to see how many people have liked their picture. That's what it means to follow, to follow someone on one of these social media sites, to check mark that you like their picture, or to make a comment on one of their posts. But biblically speaking, to follow someone meant that you actually got up, that you left your house, you left your family if need be. You went and you followed their teachings, you followed their ways, you followed in their footsteps, you walked how they walked. You got up and you followed. Matthew 16, verses 24 through 27 tell us this. Then Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for me will find it. What good will it be for a man if he gains the whole world, yet forfeits his soul? Or what can a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward each person according to what he has done." To follow Jesus means we get up off the couch, means we leave our homes, it means we carry our crosses, which is a short way of saying we are willing to die of ourselves to live for others. We're willing to die of ourselves to live for others. It means we follow Jesus. And you can't follow someone unless you put them in front of you. You can't follow by putting Jesus behind you. And the scriptures tell us that if we want to be true disciples of Jesus Christ, we must follow him. We must put him in front. Even if it means denying ourselves so that we can live our lives for him. You know, according to worldly success, Jesus ended his earthly life here as a failure. If you just want to look at earthly success, Jesus ended his earthly life as a failure. He died homeless, broke, betrayed, and incarcerated. But you know, when you read the Gospels, when you read the Bible, when you read about Jesus' life, he was the most content, the most peaceful, the most loving, the most joyful person you would ever meet. And when we look at Jesus' example, we soon learn that contentment, that you can be content regardless if you have a lot or a little. You can be joyful regardless of what comes your way. Looking at Jesus, we are reminded that life is so much more. It's so much more than obtaining, you know, your dream job. Life is so much more than a big house. Life is so much more than retiring with a pension. Jesus wants us to be content, loving, joyful, peaceful. Life is so much more than the possessions we gain. Life is about the people we love and the sacrifices we make for others. Paul talks about the fruit of the Spirit. And Paul says that when you are true disciples of Jesus, you will be filled with the Spirit. And Paul describes the fruit of the Spirit this way: it is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. You know, one of our milestones is commitment to purity. You know, really, that's purity and singleness, faithfulness and marriage. And how do we do that? Believe me, you can't do it by willpower. You can only do it by the grace of God. You can only do it as a disciple of Jesus. Because as a disciple, you gain these fruits of the Spirit, which includes faithfulness and self-control. Disciples follow. They follow their master. They follow the Christ, his teachings, his ways, and they follow in his footsteps. To be a disciple of Jesus means we follow. A second characteristic of being Jesus' disciple: Jesus' disciples gather. They gather. Hebrews 10:25 tells us, "Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." Let us not give up meeting together. You know, I have people tell me, you know, I am closest to God in nature, that I really don't need to attend church. I find God in my own way. Now, I love nature. I love nature. I love going for a walk. I love taking a hike. But I know as a Christian, I need to gather with other Christians. God created us to be in relationship. In the Garden of Eden, when he created Adam, he looked at Adam and said, "It is not good for him to be alone." He needs a helpmate, and so God created Eve. We all need people to help us. We need people to encourage us. Now, this is not to say the church is a perfect place, right? I mean, the church is not a perfect place. Sometimes, and now, when I'm referring to the church, I'm referring to the universal church, right? You'll find this in every church. But you know, that there are times, you know, we're called to be an encourager, but there are times in the church where instead of encouraging, we can discourage. We're people, after all. Yeah, you have a ministry that you love, and someone new comes to it and says, "You know, I'd love to help you out." And you say, "Okay, that's great." And then they have a new suggestion, a new idea, and you say, "Well, we've never done it that way." And you just dismiss it because it's a new idea, because you've never done it that way. Believe me, if you want to discourage someone, that's the best way to do it. Or someone is truly hurting, someone has truly messed up their lives, and they need a brother or sister in Christ to come and to encourage them. They need someone to walk alongside them, to pray with them, to be there with them. Instead, we talk about them behind their backs. Then you throw in gossip, throw in judgmentalism, you throw in Phariseeism, which is being concerned more about the law than other people. And sometimes the church can be a hard place to be. All of a sudden, we're just nitpicking at each other, right? Kind of reminds me of a short short film I once saw. It was entitled "For the Birds," and it kind of tells you what happens when all you do is nitpick. And I'd like to show it for you this morning. It's only about 2.5-3 minutes long. "For the Birds." See, you know, when all you do is nitpick, when all you do is discourage, it not only hurts the other person, it hurts the body of Jesus Christ, that we are all less. And you know, we can't control what other people do, but we can control our words, we can control our thoughts. So I just want to remind you to be an encourager. Next time that, you know, that gossipy thought comes into your head, just kind of wipe it clean, right? We are called to encourage. We'll never be a perfect church. We'll never be a perfect place. But we always can get better. We always can grow. We can put away childish things and start doing things as a disciple of Jesus. Third characteristic of Christ's disciples, Jesus' disciples love. John 13, verses 34 and 35. Jesus says, "A new command I give you, love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. By this all men will know that you are my disciples if you love one another." So how will the world know that we are Jesus' disciples? Will they know that we are his disciples by the songs we sing? No. Will they know that we are Jesus' disciples by the church we attend? No. Will they know we're disciples by how much of the Bible we read? Not what Jesus says. Rather, what Jesus says, they will know that you are my disciples by how much you love. By how much you love. As Sarah mentioned, you know, we got peanut brittle coming up. We make 4,000 pounds of peanut brittle. We raise over $20,000, and you know, we use that $20,000 for ministries here at the church. It's an important fundraiser we do with Peanut Brittle. If you're not signed up, sign up. I mean, it's great that we have that, we can support these ministries. And I know a lot of people in our community know us by our Peanut Brittle. But I am so much more proud that there's a group of kids down in Haiti that simply know us by our love. Of how we have a group who go down there every year just to shower them with the love of Jesus. I'm so much more proud that there are kids over at Eastside Elementary School who simply know us by our love. That we have volunteers to go over there to help some of those kids out. One of the teachers just recently commented that when we go into that school, we are like a fresh of breath air. You know, I'll be at McDonald's and I'll have a kid come up and, you know, give me a hug. The first thing I do, I have to turn to the parents and say, I'm not a creeper. I know I'm from Eastside. Or sometimes I know I'm from our daycare. You know, I'm so much more proud of the many people in this community who know us by our love, those people whom we have roofed homes for, those people we have helped feed, those people we have helped clothe. I'm so much more proud of the people down in Henderson, Kentucky who simply know us by our love. And these are just a few of the things we do so that people will know us by our love. How will they know you are a disciple of Jesus? By the way you love them. There's one more characteristic I want to lift up. And this is Jesus' disciples multiply. Jesus' disciples multiply. Jesus' disciples make other disciples. The Great Commission, Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you to the very end of the age. Jesus commands each and every one of us, and I'm not sure we can be a disciple without doing this. Jesus says, if you want to be my disciples, you will make other disciples. You will share my message with other people. You know, I believe that each and every one of us, we have our own sphere of influence, right? We have our own sphere of influence. Our group of friends, our group of coworkers, a group of students that we hang out with. We all have our sphere of influence, and God's calling us to reach though in our sphere of influence. Now mine might not be, you know, the devil's disciples, right? That might not be my sphere of influence. Although, you know, God is kind of playing tricks with me, I'm telling you. God is just kind of messing with my mind. Because we're at that gas station, there's the devil's disciples, and you know, honestly, I mean, we laugh, but I mean, there's no way I was getting out and talking to those guys. And that, you know, that gal with the t-shirt on. But yet, yesterday morning, my 11-year-old son is playing in the Concord School Football League, right? Concord School Football League. So we're out there for the games. You know, there's lots of kids, lots of parents. One of the parents had a t-shirt on. And I can't really tell you what it said because it was a little vulgar. But the gist of it was, don't mess with me or I will hit you. I mean, that's what it said. Don't mess with me or I will hit you. And in the center of the t-shirt was the logo and design for the devil's disciples. I'd never known about the devil's disciples, and now within a couple weeks, I've seen them twice. But I'm telling God, I need a third time before I even start to consider anything, you know? Really, it's not my cup of tea. I know some of you will be praying that God gives me a third sign, but we all have our sphere of influence. And I don't want to, psych you out or anything and get you scared of what you need to do, but sometimes I give you an assignment, something to work on. What I want you to work on today, before next Sunday. Come up with one person. Just one person. Whom you can disciple. And really, it's kind of easy. The way you begin that is just to pray for him. I mean, that's all you got to do at this point, right? Pray for him every day. Pray for him. That God will soften their heart, that they will know Jesus, Jesus' love. Just pray for them. Pray that God will open a door so that you can share with them how Jesus has impacted your life. And if you can't come up with a way of how Jesus has impacted your life, maybe you need to put your name on the sheet of paper. But just pray for them. And if you can't think of a name, just write down coworker. So God will give you a coworker or a classmate, a friend or family member. Because I'm really not sure if we can be a disciple without making disciples. Therefore, go, Jesus says, and make disciples of all nations. So that we can stand before God one day, right? So we can stand before Jesus, and he will look at us, and he will know our name. And he will say, well done. Good and faithful steward. Good and faithful servant. Well done. Would you please pray with me? Most gracious God, we thank you that you invite us to be a part of your family. We thank you for the saving grace of Jesus. That Jesus loves us so much. He doesn't leave us as we are, but he transforms us. He makes us into a new person through the power of the Holy Spirit. Not by our own thinking or way of doing things, but by the power of the Holy Spirit. We become new people. We become transformed. We become disciples. We get up and we follow. Dear God, give us the strength to be your disciples. Give us a name, dear God. Give us each person here a name of someone that you're calling to pray for that person. That God will open up a door that you can share with them how Jesus has impacted your life. Give us each a name. May we all come to you. May we know the fruit of your Spirit. And may we be Jesus' disciples. But God, we thank you for these many things. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you please stand with me as we join together in our closing song?